My super risen Savior is in the world today. I know that He is living, whatever men may say. I see His hand of mercy, I hear His voice of cheer. And just the time I need Him, He's always near. He lives, He lives, He lives where Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along the narrow way. He lives, He lives.
Sunday, I mentioned about the church cleanup, that I don't just have the church cleanup because we need to do a little cleaning up here and there. Years ago, when I was the janitor, boy, I tell you, I loved the church cleanup because there was a lot of things, a lot of extra things that I did not do as the janitor, did not have time to do, that got done. Baseboards, door handles, the door jams got wiped down and cleaned once, twice a year. But what I have found in my life is that when you work with people, you bond with people. It's no coincidence that God chose the Passover meal as His last ordination for the church. He's only given us two, and that's baptism and the Lord's Supper. It's because both we ingest those symbols of Him through the bread and the wine or the juice, the blood of the grape. And we ingest, and therefore we are symbolically taking in that which represents Him. But also because people bond not just over work, but they bond over food. You know, they bond over food, the breaking of bread. Many, many wonderful things have happened over the breaking of bread. So I try to give you an opportunity to both work together and sup together. Amen. And if you take advantage of it, I think it's a blessed thing. That being said, are we ready, Bill? Okay, so we'll go lights, camera, action.
Yeah, well, He'll take Just think about Moses in front of the burning bush, barefoot on the holy ground. You know we must have been thinking, hey, what's an old dude like me gonna tell them all when I go down?
Go down, Moses.
The Lord said, hey, Mo, don't you worry about you going down south. I'll be saying every word that comes out of your mouth. You just keep doing your best and pray that it's blessed. Hey, Mo, I'll take care of the rest. Yes, the Lord said that he'd take care of the rest. He's gonna do it, but he'll take care of the rest. He'll see a threat, yeah, but he'll take care of the rest. Oh, Pharaoh blew it. He'll take care of the, he'll take care of the rest. Just believe, and you'll receive that comfort you need. You just think about all those lonely people you know. They got everything they want, but they got empty souls. Well, he'll take care of the, he'll take care of the, he'll take care of the, care of the rest. You just think about Noah, toting his umbrella when there wasn't a cloud in the sky. All his neighbors would laugh at his petty rap, and they would, oh, snicker as he passed by. But the Lord said, hey, Noah, be cool. Just keep building that boat. It's just a matter of time till they see who's gonna float. You just keep doing your best and pray that it's blessed. Hey, Noah, I'll take care of the rest. I'm the weatherman.
The Lord said that he'll take care of the rest.
He's gonna do it.
He'll take care of the rest.
He'll see a threat, yeah.
But he'll take care of the rest.
His neighbors blew it.
Father in heaven, greatest God Almighty, thank you, Lord, for this night. We thank you for laughter, Father. We thank you for the young people upstairs. We pray that your will is being shared with them through the word, that they are bonding in fellowship by your Holy Spirit. And pray that you help me to preach your word tonight. And, well, I pray that you help me communicate it better than I communicated with Bill this afternoon. Forgive me, Lord. Lord, I thank you again for all those who showed up on Monday night. We don't do it as a fundraiser, Lord. We don't need raised funds. You own it all. But it sure was fun. It sure was fun. I love being around your people. I love your people because they love you. We pray, Father God, that that love will be seen by any and all who have passed by this church. And that they would come to the knowledge, the blessed knowledge of Jesus Christ as the Lord and Savior of the lost. That he has come dying a sinless, or living a sinless life, dying a vicarious death on the cross, that whosoever shall believe in him shall never perish. Lord, we pray that we will see baptisms, even as I believe there's two more scheduled for this Sunday. We praise you for that, Father. Continue to stir these waters, that those who would come by faith, having received you, can be called children of the Most High God, as he came unto his own, but his own received him not. And in such, Lord, they are not children of God, but children of wrath. Tonight, as we look into your word, I just pray again that your Spirit, your Holy Spirit, and only your Holy Spirit will speak through the reading and preaching of your word. It'll translate to the inner man and woman here that is born again. Should there be any man or woman here who doesn't know your son, Jesus Christ, not a religion, not a creed, not a church, but your son, Jesus Christ, as their Lord and Savior, may they tonight understand that there is jeopardy to be had not receiving Christ. There is jeopardy. They are in jeopardy. Jeopardy of being eternally separated from you. Father, again, I love you and I praise you for enabling all that you would enable. Obviously, that video didn't need to get played tonight. Lord, I ask, maybe we play it Sunday. We love you and we praise you in Jesus' name. And all of God's people said, amen and amen. Well, we are in this series as we're going through 1 Corinthians that I have titled The World, the Flesh, and the Devil. For those who haven't been here in a while, for those who are new tonight, let me go ahead and explain why the series is called The World, the Flesh, and the Devil. The church at Corinth was a worldly church. They had been living and indeed directed by their flesh. The flesh is something that is apart from God. The flesh and the works of the flesh, if you're following my Instagram post daily, I'm going through chapter 5, verses 17, 18, and 19 even now, and I'm going through each work of the flesh succinctly. Today's word was wrath. The work of the flesh, is wrath. That is an expression of vengeful anger, an intense expression of vengeful anger. And yet we have a God, who poured out his wrath. But God is spirit, and he cannot act in the flesh, for he is not of flesh. He is love, and yet it is said in Psalms that there is such a thing as a perfect hate. A perfect hate. What is a perfect hate? A perfect hate is that which separates the sinner from their sin. Loving the sinner, hating the sin is a perfect hate. In God's wrath, he is not controlled by his emotions. As a perfect and holy being, thrice holy as the Bible describes him, there is no variation in him. There are no emulations in him. There is no variance. And as such, his wrath will be poured out on this planet one day. Why do I mention that? Because that's why we're going to go back over the verses in chapter 8 of 1 Corinthians, verses 1 through 3 or 4, because I want to talk a little bit more about idols. Idols. Sunday, I kind of expounded upon the idols a little bit in the sense of superstition and personal convictions, and that we know that there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ. If a woman were to wear pants, that's not a sin. However, if a woman desireth to be a man, that's not going to lead anywhere good. See, one is a superficial thing. The other is something that God calls an abomination. And same for a man. If a man, it's not a sin for a man to wear a kilt. However, if a man were to dress up as a woman and indeed claim to be a woman, this is an abomination unto God. And it's tantamount to idolatry. Why? Because you're putting yourself, your own personal feelings, above A, what Scripture has said, and B, how God has made you. You say, well, if God made me to feel like a woman, why wouldn't he want me to be a woman? I say this again, not to ruffle feathers, but just to speak a practical truth. If you were born a man, how do you know what it's like to feel like a woman? You don't know. You have an idea. You may admire that. You may be interested in that. But you don't know what it feels like to be a woman. Best that you seek the Lord and ask him to help you be how he made you. Again, anything other than that is idolatry. That being said, what are idols? What are these idols that Paul is talking about to the Corinthians when he says, hey, and I'm paraphrasing, hey, you can eat things sacrificed to idols. It's really not that big a deal. Why? Because we know that idols are really nothing, that there is no other God but God. And yet in Psalm chapter 82, he talks and says, and ye are gods, little g. We know that Satan is the god, little g, of this world. Who is he talking to? The word God in the Old Testament, one of the words for God or gods, is Elohim. Elohim. We understand as Trinitarians, that is God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. When God in Genesis said, let us make man in our own image, he wasn't talking to a council of God. He was talking to the godly Trinity and godly Godhead, godly counsel of his Son and his Holy Spirit, making mankind in his image, as we are triune beings as well. However, we are not Elohim. What are the Elohim? I'm glad you asked. The Elohim are those angels, spiritual beings, some holy, some demonic, and some evil spirits. The angels are worshipped as God in antiquity, or gods in antiquity. Some by happenstance, others because they are demonic and they wage war against God. When you hear about ancient myths, oftentimes those myths were perpetrated and brought about by these spiritual beings. These spiritual beings, these fallen angels that did not keep their first estate. Now, these idols, these wooden images of wood, these images of gold and silver, we know are nothing. They're just things. However, the spiritual beings that they represent sometimes can be very, very real. Turn with me to Jude chapter 1, verse 6. Jude chapter 1 and verse 6, because I know I'm losing some people in here. You're probably thinking, oh, this guy's talking about a bunch of hooey. That's okay. We stick with the Bible, the whole counsel of the Bible, and look and see what the Bible says. Jude chapter 1, there is no chapter 2, so you might go right past it into Revelation. It's the last book, last epistle to be found before Revelation. Jude 1, 6 says, the angels which kept not their first estate, but left their own habitation, he hath reserved in everlasting chains under darkness until the day of that, until judgment of that, of the great day. Well, what are these that are in chains until the day of judgment in that great day? These are the worst of the worst of the offenders. These are the angels that did not keep their first estate, but are described in Genesis, basically 1 through 5, 1 through 6, as not keeping their first estate and cohabiting with women. Cohabiting with women. I heard a commentator the other day say that angels could not have cohabited with women because Jesus describes, when confronted by the Pharisees about one whose husband died and that she married a succession of brothers that died, and they wanted to know which brother will she be betrothed to in the celestial kingdom or in heaven. And he says, there is no marrying or giving in marriage in heaven. However, you will be likened unto the angels, which are neither married nor given in marriage. And he took that to say, see, they couldn't cohabitate because they can't procreate. Au contraire, mon frère, that's French. See, what he's talking about is this. Every single time an angel is mentioned in the Old or New Testament, it's always in the masculine sense. Ladies, I hate to tell you, there is no divine feminine. You will have your distinct personality, but your sexuality and our sexuality will not be needed in our resurrected bodies because we are done procreating at that point. Does that make sense to you? Will be likened unto the angels who all have a masculine tense to them. However, were not meant to procreate. Instead, not keeping their first estate, coming down from their heavenly abode, they slept with women and made offspring called the Nephilim. The Nephilim. And the Nephilim are referred to as giants and mighty men of old. There are some who think that was the devil's attempt to thwart and destroy the bloodline of humanity in order to thwart God's plan to bring about the Messiah. I don't know about that because I don't get into the devil's head all that often. It wouldn't surprise me. However, it does bring about this idea and this understanding that demons exist once having been holy, became unholy, as they followed that dragon, as with a swipe of his tail, he took a third of the stars with him, as mentioned in Revelation, and they rebelled against God. Turn with me to 2 Peter, chapter 2 and verse 4. 2 Peter in chapter 2 and verse 4. Peter writes in his epistle of those angels that were not spared from God's judgment and wrath. He says, "For if God hath spared not the angels that sinned, but cast them down to hell and delivered them unto chains of darkness to be reserved unto judgment, and spared not the old world, but saved Noah, the eighth person, a preacher of righteousness, bringing in the flood upon the world and the ungodly." He's talking about how God destroyed the old world through the flood, and with it, the Nephilim, the offspring, and those demons, those angels that did not keep their first estate. Satan has been allowed to roam the planet. Although I believe he is the chief of the angels who fell at that time, as he led the rebellion, he has been allowed to roam the planet to and fro as a lion seeking whom he might devour. Not all of the demons were put into chains and in the abyss until the day of judgment. Many have been allowed to walk the planet. Now, you say, why would God do that? Well, why does a nail fasten a board? Why does a hammer strike so hard? Is it the nail that pierces? Is it the hammer that gains the glory? No, it's the one that fashioned it and wielded it for his purposes. Another name in esoteric occultic circles for Satan is the nail. Is the nail. Yet we do not venerate the nails that were used to hang Jesus Christ on the cross. No more than we venerate the hammer or the men who strung him up. However, we do love and worship the God who came up with this plan of redemption before the beginning of time, knowing that not only would his angels rebel, but his creation would rebel, and they would need a redeemer. So he sent his only begotten son to die this death. Does this make sense to you today? So God has allowed these nails, some of them are just pinpricks, some of them, like Satan, are mighty and ferocious. But listen to what it says. He roams to and fro about the earth like a lion. He is not a lion. He roars, seeking whom he should devour. Why does he roar first? Because he wants us to fear and tremble. The demons know God and they tremble. It is not enough to believe in a God. It is not enough to believe in God. You must trust Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. There is no other way. He is the way, the truth, and the life. Not only do the waves and the storm obey his command, but when he met the demoniac in Gadara, who was filled with what was called a legion of spirits, for they were many, he commanded them to go out and into the pigs. It seems as though these disembodied spirits would rather possess pigs than be cast out to roam to and fro. We've talked about demons. Let's talk about the spirits now. I told you about the angels that did not keep their first estate, right? It is said that when God fashioned Adam out of the dust of the earth, that he breathed into him and he became a living spirit. That is what separates mankind from all other creatures on the planet. Now, that being said, if the angels did not keep their first estate, they cohabited with women and their offspring became the Nephilim, how is it that they became living spirits. God did not create that. He allowed that, but he did not create that. So now, after the flood, we have a race of beings whose spirit is caught somewhere between heaven and hell. Spiritual beings, I believe, are eternal. Only God has the power to destroy a spirit. That being said, I believe that the Bible points to these spirits as being the disembodied spirits of these offspring of angels and women, the Nephilim. Let me turn to my notes again. In 1 Samuel, God sent an evil spirit to vex Saul. God sent an evil spirit to vex Saul. Turn with me to 1 Kings chapter 22 and verse 22. 1 Kings chapter 22 and verse 22. We'll end up in verse 22. We're going to start in verse 18. 1 Kings 22:18-22. The king of Israel said unto Jehoshaphat, Did I not tell thee he would prophesy? He's talking about the prophet that came and didn't give him any good news. Would not prophesy good concerning me, but evil. And he said, Hear thou, therefore, the word of the Lord. I saw the Lord sitting on the throne, and all the hosts of heaven standing by him on his right hand and on his left. The prophet begins to describe God's heavenly throne room. And he says, the hosts of heaven are there on his right hand and his left hand. The hosts of heaven are commonly known as the angels. He says, these hosts of heavens are on the right and the left hand. And the Lord said, who shall persuade Ahab, this king who's whining, this wicked king who's whining and complaining about only getting evil prophesied against him? He said, who will persuade Ahab that he may go up and fall at the battle? I'm not going to try and Ramoth Gilead. I could pronounce that. I'm a big boy. And he said on this manner, and another said on that manner. So there's a discussion going on in the heavenly courts of God. And there came forth a spirit, little s, not the Holy Spirit, not the Holy Ghost, a spirit, a pneuma, and stood before the Lord. So how does this pneuma, this wind, this breath, come and stand before the Lord, except for they are able to incorporate some sort of manifestation? And he comes and the spirit stands before the Lord and said, I will persuade him. And the Lord said unto him, wherewith? And he said, I will go forth, and I will be what? A lying spirit in the mouth of all of Ahab's prophets, all of his prophets. And he said, thou shalt persuade him and prevail also. Go forth and do so. Wow. There's an evil spirit volunteering to lie in the courts of God. I don't know about you, but that kind of fries the old noodle. You know, if God is righteous, and I know he is, and I'm going to give you some scriptures that state it succinctly. What is this all about? God is not the hammer, nor is he the nail. However, being the grand architect of all things, he knows that there is a drama that is playing out on this planet. And he knows who he's dealing with. He's dealing with Ahab. Ahab wants to hear a lie. Ahab does not want to hear that he's going to fall at Ramah at Gilead. He wants to hear that he's going to be victorious, even though he has been rebellious against the God of his fathers, even though he has been ugly, even though he has been a liar himself. He wants to be that one that is ever victorious, regardless of his sin. Well, let me turn back to my notes, see where we are. I don't know why I'm a little distracted tonight. Okay, I'll tell you what. We've talked a little bit about the spirits. We've talked about where they come from, their etymology. Now let's talk about how we relate to them. But before we do, turn with me to Psalm 92. Psalm 92, verses 12 through 15. Lest you think I am besmirching God. Everything okay, Devin? All right, man. You take care. Let me know how it all comes out. Psalm 92, verses 12 through 15. The righteous shall flourish. Who are the righteous? Those who live by faith. The Bible says the righteous shall live by faith. The righteous shall flourish like the palm tree, and he shall grow like the cedars of Lebanon. Those that he planted in the house of the Lord shall flourish in the courts of our God. They shall bring forth their fruit in old age. No reason to forsake the Lord at a certain age. You don't ever really retire from God's kingdom. He says, they shall bring forth fruit in old age and shall be fat and flourishing. I like fat. Plump even. To show that the Lord is what? Upright. He is our rock. And there is no unrighteousness in him. There is no unrighteousness in him. Therefore, although God may allow demons and even assign evil spirits, there is no unrighteousness in him. We just trust that God knows what he's doing. Amen. And we must know and understand that these things exist that we might thwart the schemes of Satan. Let's go back to this question. Why study this now in the midst of the world, the flesh, and the devil? Well, there was an idol in 1 Samuel called Dagon. They found out pretty quick that that thing was just made of wood. One day they set God's holy things there, the Ark of the Covenant and such. The next day they came in, Dagon was on his face with his hands cut off. Well, they set him back up. Next day they came in, it wasn't on its face because its head was cut off. Things made by hands are meaningless. They're inconsequential. However, there are spirits out there, spirits, evil spirits, and demons that war against us. So what are we to do? Well, first and foremost, y'all be saved. If you're not saved, what I will tell you is this, you carry as a consequence not only eternal damnation, but I will tell you this, you also carry with you the very likelihood that you will be possessed and inhabited by an evil spirit, possibly even a demon, and it will not result in anything good. You say, well, I did. I think I did have a demon, but I kicked methamphetamines. Great. And what did you do after that? Well, honestly, I took up heroin, but I kicked meth. Well, there's a principle there. You substitute one habit for another, what will happen is it'll just be seven times worse. Turn with me to Matthew chapter 12. Matthew chapter 12. Jesus is speaking of an unclean spirit in Matthew chapter 12, starting in verse 43. There was an unclean spirit that was inhabiting a man. When the unclean spirit had gone out of the man, he walketh through dry places, seeking rest and finding none. Now, that's an interesting turn of phrase. Why, you know, the Holy Spirit's very deliberate in the things that he says. Why is it that you might think that this spirit is seeking dry places? How did God destroy the world to begin with? With the flood. One of the things about being a incorporeal spiritual being, you got a perfect memory. It was terrifying as each one of the Nephilim drowned. Well, you know, it's one of the reasons I think that Desert Hills and those God-fearing, Bible-believing, spirit-filled churches here in Las Vegas are on the cutting edge of ministry. This is a very dry place. It's no wonder we have so much vice and sin here. That's not unique to Las Vegas. But it is propagated. It says that this spirit, he goes out of the man and he walketh through dry places, seeking rest and finding none. Then this spirit saith, I will return into my house. What house is that? The man that he was living in. He said, I will return into my house from whence I came out. And when he is come, he findeth it empty, swept and garnished. See, he kicked the habits. He said, man, you know, I'm feeling better today. Something's different. And he doesn't know, but the spirits left him to go to dry places seeking some rest. Because honestly, probably the person he's living in is getting on his nerves. So he leaves. There's no grace, no mercy in an evil spirit, for sure. So he leaves. And when he leaves, suddenly the countenance is lifted and they think, great. You know what? I'm going to quit smoking, drinking, and chewing. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to live a moral life. I'm not going to hear any evil, say any evil, speak any evil, or see any evil. I'm going to be a good man. That man is self-deceived. Do you know why? Because the Bible says there are none good, no, not one.
Right.
That all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And if you think that you are moral in and of your own self, what I want to tell you is this. You're going to be a highly moral person writhing in hell. You're going to help a little old lady across the street. You're going to do good works and you're going to be a nice person and you're going to bite your tongue instead of cursing. When actually what you should have done is confess Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Humbled yourself before Almighty God and said, I am a sinner and I am in need of forgiveness. I need salvation. I need Jesus. Once having done that, the Holy Spirit moves in. And when the Holy Spirit moves in, there is no room for any other spirit.
Amen.
Greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. There is no room for the Holy Spirit. I mean, for the unclean spirit, when the Holy Spirit comes, yeah. Forgive me. Now, he says here that this evil spirit comes, and what does he find? He finds the man. He's cleaned his act up. He's a nice, moral, sweet man. Everybody likes him. He's even on the PTA. And he finds it empty and swept and garnished and put in order. Then he goeth and taketh with himself the evil spirit, seven other spirits more wicked than himself. And they enter in and dwell there. And the last state of that man is worse than the first. Even so shall it be unto this wicked generation. So we go from the microcosm, the small picture of a man who is possessed by an evil spirit, to an entire generation. What I want to tell you is this. This is the generation. In the end times, it's going to be seven times worse than it ever has been. Oh, not worse than the genocide from World War II. That's nothing. It's child's play. It's like birth pangs. I heard a little bit, but we've had 50, 60 years of relative peace on the planet in that grand sense. Relative world wars, if you catch my drift. But there's coming a day where God is going to release his monsters on this planet. God has monsters to enact and exact his wrath. Not a work of the flesh. Not something that is wielded in irrational and knee-jerk reaction and emotion, but the wrath that is being stored up for those who will not repent. For John says in 1 John, little children, keep yourselves from idols. Why? Because the spiritual entities behind them want nothing but for your destruction. They want nothing but for confusion and chaos on this planet. And they'll kill you if they get a chance. It's exactly 7:30 right now. I got about an hour and a half more message. Can we stay a little bit longer? I got about 5 minutes. We good? I've got some actions that I want to give you with some scriptures. You don't have to go there. Just write them down. Okay? We're talking about evil spirits now. Demons, simple, man. I mean, they're unholy angels. They've fallen, didn't keep their first estate. They're wicked. They're disgusting. They're going to get thrown into the pit and the lake of fire, the whole bit. But these spirits, I want to give you some actions that you can see an evil spirit in. In Acts chapter 16, verse 16 and 18, we see a woman with a spirit of divination. Excuse me, a spirit of divination. She foretells the future. She's a fortune teller. Tarot cards are her game. Palm reading, her act. Communing with the dead, which is an abomination in witchcraft. Divination is an evil act from an evil spirit. God is able to save the woman. That spirit, however, will be damned. That's Acts chapter 16, 16 through 18. The spirit of divination. 1 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 1. There is a deceitful spirit. A spirit that deceives. A spirit that will not endure sound doctrine. It is a deceitful spirit. And this is an action of an evil spirit. Divination, deceiving and deceitful. 2 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 7. It is the spirit of fear and timidity. That is an evil spirit. We've not been given a spirit of fear and timidity. We've been given the spirit of love and power and of a sound mind. That's the Holy Spirit. But when we tremble before anything save the Lord, it is the action of an evil spirit, a spirit of fear and timidity, 2 Timothy 1:7. And last, as 1 John chapter 4 and verse 6, we have the spirit of error and falsehood. Right before we came up here today, we were listening to Aaron Rodgers on the freeway on the way here. Love Aaron Rodgers. Miss him. Look him up. Sound doctrine. Good preacher. You're not going to go wrong with Aaron Rodgers. He's got a voice, man. Come on. That guy, he's a crooner almost. Right after Aaron Rodgers came on, there was a woman that my mother, sorry, Kim. I don't know who's cringing more, my mother or my wife. My wife used to get her daily devotions. And she says, Scott, this one here, she says, hey, we ought to be prophesying women. She says, she's empowering women to get into the pulpits, you know. And that sounds good, especially if you're a feminist. I don't know why you got to get into a pulpit. Not for you. The Bible says that it's husband of one wife, be a pastor, preacher. I encourage women to share their testimony. I do. I encourage biblical sound doctrine in it. Kim says, I had to stop her devotions. And I said, well, why is that? What else did she do? Is she Beth Morin out or something, you know? She goes, yeah. She started talking about the lioness arising. Ah, who said I will arise? I will arise above the God Most High. I will arise. You know what? I'm not trying to arise. I haven't even arrived. I am in Christ. He is risen, and so am I. No, it is a spirit of error and falsehood. And I don't know why ladies tend to fall for it more than men. Although the men that follow them, boy, I tell you what, they're hook, line, and sinker. It's a spirit of error and falsehood. We're not given a spirit of error. We worship in spirit and in truth. How do you do that? Devin, I'm glad you asked. You can only worship in spirit and truth if you've been born again of the Spirit. Because it is the Spirit that discerns the things of God. Worshiping in spirit, He leads us into all truth and teaches us all righteousness. He leads us not into temptation, but where? Into God's presence. Not to arise and be above, but that we might kneel and adore. It is a spirit that we have of Christ, a spirit of humility, who took on a crown of thorns, though he is due and has received the crown of glory. That's the spirit that we have. Idols, whether they be carved by hand, conceptual, philosophical, they're really nothing. They will all burn. But there is a spiritual realm. It is backed by powerful, demonic, and evil spirits. And one day, after we're gone, by the way, we're going to be called up out of here, you know, in the rapture. But one day, as it's spoken of in Revelation chapter 9, go home and read that for your bedtime story tonight. God is going to let loose his monsters on this planet because they are both the hammer and the nail, and judgment will be exacted. I don't preach like this often, church. You know that. But I want to tell you, when I tell you things like I believe we're in the end times, that's not just lip service. We need to be calling people to repentance. We need to let them know there's a jeopardy in this. You can, hey man, you can walk around and say, I'm okay, you're okay, it's okay not to be okay. That's fine. But the monsters are coming. God is serious. He loves you. And he desires that none perish, but that all men and women, all boys and girls, repent and come to the saving knowledge and grace of his only begotten Son, Jesus Christ. That's not just my job. No, that's a good job tonight, preacher. You preach it. You live it. You share it. I'm one man. How many are you? 100, 150 strong? God changed the world with 12 men. If you have the Holy Spirit, think about what he could do through you. He said, not little old me. That's what I feel all the time, Devin. But see, God used a donkey too. Put an angel right in the middle of the road. Balaam, donkey goes off into the ditch. Balaam starts punching the donkey. Donkey turns around and says, hey, man, haven't I always been a faithful donkey to you, Balaam? He goes, why are you hitting me? I'm a good donkey. You're a bad rider. About that time, God let Balaam see that there was an angel there that would have killed him. Imagine what he said to the donkey. So sorry, donkey. Be nice to me now. Hey, call me a jackass. I don't care. If I get you to steer from the oncoming destruction, I say praise God and pass the sugar. Amen.